Welcome. This is Unit 10 of the Expert Track. In this session, we will take a more in-depth look at the similarities and differences between Eco-DRR and EBA. Here are our learning questions for this session. Which are the similarities and differences between Eco-DRR and EBA? What are the benefits of further integrating Eco-DRR and EBA? In Unit 3, we already mentioned some similarities and differences between DRR and CCA. Do you remember? We discussed that, for example, both fields address hazards such as floods, droughts, and landslides. But DRR also deals with hazards that are not climate-related, such as tsunamis, earthquakes, volcanic eruptions, dust storms, and avalanches. CCA, in turn, deals with long-term hazards such as sea level rise and long-term changes to temperature and rainfall patterns, which are not in the focus of DRR. Feel free to revisit Unit 3 to refresh your memory. As components of these fields, Eco-DRR and EBA share the same differences, but they have even more similarities, given their common focus on ecosystems. Let's talk about similarities first. As ecosystem-based measures are common areas for both approaches, they can be considered as the de facto bridges between the two. Many ecosystem-based activities in both EBA and Eco-DRR are the same. These include, for instance, forest management, mangrove or wetlands restoration. Such measures contribute to increased resilience of societies and human security. But there are also differences. Some of these emerge from the starting points of each field. EBA proponents tend to come from natural resources, environmental and conservation communities, while Eco-DRR proponents tend to emanate from disaster, development and humanitarian communities. Because of its roots in conservation, EBA has a stronger focus on biodiversity and long-term impacts of climate change on ecosystems. These include acknowledging that ecosystems themselves adapt to climate change. EBA projects may therefore adapt improved management of protected areas and use biodiversity and wildlife corridors, whereas Eco-DRR rarely includes such aspects. EBA projects may also be careful about selecting species for planting that are suitable to emerging new climatic conditions, for example, drought or salt-resistant seeds. EBA also acknowledges potential increase in pest or disease outbreaks in the future. Eco-DRR, on the other hand, has its roots in development and humanitarian fields. It therefore combines ecosystem-based measures with more conventional DRR measures, such as early warning, evacuation, preparedness, risk mapping, and contingency plans. Compared to EBA, Eco-DRR has a greater focus on reducing immediate risks from current hazards events, such as loss of lives, livelihoods, food and water security. Further integrating Eco-DRR and EBA approaches has multiple benefits for both fields and avoids maladaptation and unintentional increase in risks. To do so, Eco-DRR projects need to take into account long-term climatic change to avoid maladaptation. Eco-DRR could also benefit from EBA knowledge to climate-proof its interventions and ensure their sustainability. For example, it can consider adaptation of ecosystems to climate change and using species that are suitable to future climatic conditions. This applies for both adaptations to latitudinal and altitudinal shifts of climatic zones. A typical example is stabilizing slopes in alpine regions that are affected by melt of glaciers and permafrost. Similarly, EBA projects can benefit from considering multiple hazards beyond climate-induced ones, as well as short-term hazards. A proper management of dune systems, for instance, can help mitigating long-term effects of sea level rise and salinization, and at the same time protect from hazards such as storms and tsunamis. EBA can also learn from Eco-DRR's more encompassing approach to disaster risk reduction. for example, by incorporating early warning or preparedness. On the other hand, Eco-DRR could benefit by incorporating more long-term considerations of climate change impacts in several sectors. Both Eco-DRR and EBA projects almost always involve partnering with environmental agencies or ministries and environmental NGOs, given the clear emphasis on the environment. They also generally partner with actors from key development sectors, such as agriculture, water, and urban development. Both recognize the importance of mainstreaming DRR and CCA in national and local development policies, programs, and plans. Additionally, EBA projects could benefit from working closer with humanitarian agencies. EBA projects often work with national governments on national adaptation plans, the so-called NAPAs. Eco-DRR projects, on the other hand, aim to work and influence DRR and environmental policies at national and local levels. The UNEP Eco-DRR project in the Democratic Republic of Congo, for instance, is working with the Ministry of Environment to integrate ecosystem management and DRR in the National Water Resources Management Policy. However, this is still challenging, given the marginal roles played by environmental ministries within DRR. EBA and Eco-DRR are generally undertaken by very separate communities, due to difference in policy and funding tracks. This institutional divide and rhetoric make the two approaches appear as very different, even though there are many more similarities than differences. Nevertheless, both approaches would benefit from further integration and cross-learning. This concludes Unit 10 of the Expert Track. Get ready for the next unit when you will be asked to incorporate EBA measures into your project from Unit 9.